everyone. Welcome to another installment of This Week in Jewish History. This week we'll be talking a little bit about a very important book called Nathan the Wise, or Nathan der Weise in German. The inspiration for this very important book in German literature and in the history of the Haskalah was written by Gotthold Ephraim Lessing, and he had the inspiration for it in August of 1778, when he wrote in a letter to his brother regarding the situation of the Jews in Germany at the time. Lessing, of course, was a non-Jew, but he was very much influenced by his close contemporary Moses Mendelssohn, whose dates are almost identical to his own. They were close friends. Mendelssohn was a fascinating figure who was shown here, by the way, in the red jacket on the left, and Lessing is standing behind the chessboard. Here, Mendelssohn is having a debate with one of his critics, Lavater, and Mendelssohn was a fascinating figure who advocated the acceptance of Jews in larger German society. Mendelssohn was himself an observant Jew, fully Shomer Shabbat and Shomer Mitzvot, although he had difficulty articulating a version of Judaism that would withstand modernizing pressures, and in fact, all of his surviving grandchildren, save one, ultimately converted to Christianity. That's a topic for another lecture. At any rate, Mendelssohn was the inspiration for Lessing's work, Nathan the Wise, which basically takes off on a ring parable. He probably got the idea from an early Italian writer, Boccaccio, in which there's this parable of a father who hands down to his son a special ring that will give him the powers to be beloved by both God and by other people. This ring is handed down for generations, father to son, until finally there is one son, one father, who has three sons, and in his quote-unquote foolish piety, he promises the ring to each of the three brothers. After he dies, the young men discover that there are three rings now. Obviously, the father has made at least two and possibly three replicas of the original, and they each possess one, but none of them know which one is the real ring. The parable here is, of course, compared to the three great Western religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, all three of which are rather exclusivist, viewing that their communication from God is, in fact, the veritable one, and the three of them disagree as to how to share their special treasure. Lessing's parable concludes with a message of tolerance, that all three brothers should realize that they have a mission to live according to the highest ideals of their faith, and they will ultimately find out in the end which one of them was the true ring, but given the existential circumstances of the moment, there's no way to determine the truth between the three of them. He set this in Crusader times with extensive dialogues between a Knight Templar, one of the Christian Crusaders, the Islamic Saladin, and a Jewish figure known as Nathan der Weise, once again modeled on Moses Mendelssohn. There was significant criticism of Nathan der Weise when it first appeared in 1779. It was held under a church ban, and Lessing's view of religious tolerance was highly criticized by many anti-Semites of the day, including the notorious Wilhelm Marr, Eugen Düring, and others, who all felt that he was capitulating to the liberal ideas of Jews such as Moses Mendelssohn. Lessing himself, however, had somewhat different views on Judaism as a whole. He's not entirely tolerant. There were a few aspects of Judaism that he found rather noxious, specifically the notion of a chosen people. He felt that Christianity had somehow, with its rationalism, superseded Judaism. But nevertheless, his work had a profound impact on the Haskalah, the Jewish Enlightenment, who viewed in Lessing a tremendous ally for their attempts to achieve emancipation in modern Germany. And that's it. I hope you enjoyed this installment, and I hope you have an excellent week.